Hello everyone, Good Shepherds High School, Belapur, welcome you all for online learning session. Standard 7th, Subject Science, Chapter number 4, Topic Nutrition in Living Organisms. Let's recall, what is malnutrition? Malnutrition is the state when the required nutrients for proper functioning of the body are not obtained through the diet. Imbalanced diet or overnutrition can cause malnutrition. Okay, children, means that malnutrition means what? See, our body needs sufficient nutrients in our body to work. But if it is lacking, then it is called as malnutrition. Which are the ways to prevent malnutrition? Answer: taking wholesome food and balanced diet is the way to prevent malnutrition. Means you should eat sufficiently. Similarly, as per our age and type of work, we have to manage our diet to prevent malnutrition. Children, if you are doing hard work, if your parents, father is doing labor work and all, he will need more food. If anybody is doing sedentary work, like sitting in the office, so they will need less food as compared to the laborers and all. Got it, children? Yes. Now, the yellow part here, see, nutrition, the heading, nutrition. The process of taking in and using food which takes place in living organisms is called nutrition. Whatever we eat, we ingest in our whatever we eat, it gets digested and the all nutrients our body gets. So the process of taking in and using food which takes place in living organisms is called nutrition. Need for nutrition: first, to supply the energy required for doing work. Second, growth and development of the body. Third, to replace the damaged cells and repair tissues. Fourth, to fight diseases. So these are the need for nutrition. There are two types of nutrition here: autotrophic nutrition and heterotrophic nutrition. What are autotrophic nutrition, children? Some organisms can produce their own food and thus nourish themselves. This is called autotrophic nutrition. Okay? And heterotrophic is what? Some organisms depend on other organisms, plants or animals for their food. This is called heterotrophic nutrition. Got it, children? Autotrophic means those who make their own food, means trees and plants. And heterotrophic means like us, we depend on plants and animals, no, children? Like that. Okay, then here comes foodstuffs. Children, foodstuffs are the substance which are ingested, we take into our body, digested and assimilated to give energy, help in growth and building health of our body. These are our foodstuffs which gives us energy and all. So children, there are nutrients. What do you mean by nutrients? Different types of food constituents which are useful and necessary for the body are called nutrients. Okay, there are two types of nutrients: macronutrients and micronutrients. Macronutrients, nutrients required in a large quantity are called macronutrients. Example: carbohydrates, proteins, fats, okay, all lipids. And micronutrients are nutrients required in very small quantity are called micronutrients. Example: minerals and vitamins. Okay, children. Next, न्यूट्रिशन इन प्लांट्स. फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन, हाउ डू प्लांट्स प्रोड्यूस देयर ओन फूड? प्लांट्स प्रिपेयर देयर ओन फूड बाय द प्रोसेस ऑफ फोटोसिंथेसिस. करेक्ट माय चिल्ड्रन? यस. सो ऑटोट्रॉपिक प्लांट्स, दोज ऑर्गेनिजम्स दैट प्रोड्यूस देयर ओन फूड आर ऑटोट्रॉपिक. करेक्ट. नाउ सी, द प्लांट्स ऑल्सो नीड फूड फॉर देयर ग्रोथ. दे कैन प्रोड्यूस देयर ओन फूड विद द हेल्प ऑफ सनलाइट एंड क्लोरोफिल. प्लांट्स मेक देयर फूड इन देयर लीव्स यूजिंग वाटर एंड न्यूट्रिएंट्स फ्रॉम द सॉइल एंड कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड फ्रॉम द एयर. दिस प्रोसेस इज कॉल्ड एज फोटोसिंथेसिस. चिल्ड्रन, दिस क्वेश्चन कैन कम फॉर योर एग्जाम्स. फोटोसिंथेसिस मीन्स व्हाट इज, एक्सप्लेन द प्रोसेस ऑफ फोटोसिंथेसिस. यू हैव टू ड्रॉ द डायग्राम ऑल्सो, यू हैव टू लेबल इट हियर. फोटोसिंथेसिस, ओके, सी हियर, ऑक्सीजन, सनलाइट, कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड, क्लोरोफिल इन द लीव्स, दैट्स व्हाई दे आर ग्रीन. हा चिल्ड्रन, एंड डाउन अंडर दैट वाटर, मिनरल्स, सॉल्ट्स. ओके, सो हियर दे हैव गिवन कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड, CO2, वाटर, H2O. With the help of sunlight and chlorophyll, they get a glucose food plus oxygen. Glucose ka formula is 6C6H12O6. Okay. Next. Here. Plants convert light energy into chemical energy and store it in the form of food. Got it, children? See, chloroplast in a leaf. Yes. Energy is transformed in process of photosynthesis. Light energy of sun is converted into chemical energy, which is stored in the form of food. Then, roots absorb water, minerals and salts from the soil. Stem transport these materials up to the leaves. Carbon dioxide from the air is taken inside from the stomata on the leaves. Okay. Then in the leaves there are chloroplasts, this, which contain chlorophyll, which absorbs sunlight and helps in the conversion of carbon dioxide and water into food. In the process of photosynthesis, oxygen is given out. The green parts of the plants that have chlorophyll perform photosynthesis. Without chlorophyll, plants can't perform photosynthesis, children. Okay. How does photosynthesis occur in dark red or purple colored green leaf? How does photosynthesis occur in dark red or purple colored leaves? Find it out. Next, transport system in plants. Children, transportation means, yes, all the nutrients have been carried out, no? From the roots and all, water, minerals, and passes to the all parts of the trees or plants. The types of transport system. How we are having road transport, rail transport, same way plants are also having their system, xylem and phloem. Functions of xylem is what? Transport of minerals and water from the roots to all aerial parts of the plants. And function of phloem is transport of the prepared food, that is glucose, from the leaves, right, to other parts of the plant. This food is either consumed or stored in different parts of the plant. See children, this blue color ones is a function of xylem and pink color ones is a function of phloem. Okay. Plants do not have separate digestive or excretory system. Got it, children? Then, Yes. Plants produce carbohydrates by the process of photosynthesis. Carbohydrates are made from carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. Okay? Proteins are made from carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. How do plants obtain the nitrogen necessary for the synthesis of proteins? Answer is, air contains gaseous nitrogen. However, plants cannot utilize gaseous nitrogen. It needs to be fixed, that is, converted into compounds. So, fixation of the nitrogen occurs by biological and atmospheric methods. Okay, now see biological fixation of nitrogen. Two different types of microorganisms bring about biological nitrogen fixation. Root nodules of leguminous plants, see this, contains the rhizobium microorganisms. These microorganisms absorb atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into its nitrate, a compound. Microorganisms like Azotobacter are present in soil. They also convert atmospheric nitrogen into nitrates. Got it, children? Now, next. Yes. Do you know atmospheric fixation of nitrogen? Lightning occur in rainy season. This causes atmospheric nitrogen and oxygen to react with each other to form nitric oxide, which is again oxidized to form nitrogen dioxide. The nitrogen dioxide dissolves in rainwater and is converted into nitric acid, HNO3. So children, learn this molecular formula also, which gets added to the soil along with rainwater. This acid reacts with different minerals in the soil and convert into salts. Plants use this nitrogen salts for their growth. Got it, children? Now, symbiotic nutrition. What is symbiotic nutrition? When two or more than two different parts, types of plants live together to fulfill their needs, such as nutrition, protection, support, etc., with each other's help, then it is known as symbiotic nutrition. Example, lichen. Children, when two or more than two different types of plants live together to fulfill their needs, such as nutrition, protection, support. So that kind of a nutrition is called as symbiotic nutrition. Got it? Example, lichen. Okay. Next, heterotrophic plants. Heterotrophic plants, plants that do not contain chlorophyll, are heterotrophic. They grow on or in the other plant body for obtaining food. They are insectivorous, saprophytic, or parasitic. Example, Loranthus, Cuscata, etc. are parasitic plants thriving on the host plants. Main bade plant par alag alag plants grow hote. Okay, They are called heterotrophic plants. Plants that do not contain chlorophyll, and they don't have chlorophyll, means they are not green, like green, jada green in color. Okay. Plants that grow on the body of other plants to obtain food are called parasitic plants. Due to the absence of chlorophyll, the cascata is completely dependent on the host plant. Hence, it is said to be a completely parasitic plants. Then, insectivorous plants. See this, Drosera burmani, means insectivorous plants feed upon insects to obtain nutrients. Such plants are generally in soil or water that is deficient in nitrogen compounds. Example, Drosera and pitcher plant. Got it? And this Drosera burmani, why it is called as? Because the scientist Johns Burman identified this plant in Sri Lanka in 1737. Hence, the plant is named after him. Next, saprophytic plants. See, these saprophytic plants, what are the features? Let me read. Saprophytic plants obtain the food from dead and decaying bodies of other organisms. Some fungi spoil the food. Some are disease causing, while some have medicinal properties. Useful fungi, yeast and few mushrooms. In fermentation process and bread making, yeast is used. Some mushrooms are used as food because they are rich source of iron and vitamins. Got it, children? Now see, always remember, food gets spoiled due to some fungi. Some fungi cause diseases or illness, while some fungi have medicinal properties. I read just now only. Now, role of nutrients and effects of their deficiency of plants on plants. Nutrients: nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, magnesium, iron, manganese, zinc. What are the functions of nitrogen? Important component of proteins, chlorophyll and cytoplasm. Effects of deficiency. What is the deficiency? Retarded, stunted growth, yellowing of leaves. This is the effect. If there is a deficiency of nitrogen, this thing happens to the leaves. Phosphorus, what are the functions? Conversion of light energy into chemical energy. And what happens if there is a deficiency? Early leaf fall, late flowering, slow growth of roots. Then, functions of potassium, necessary for metabolic activities. And what are the deficiency? What happens then? Weak stem, wilting of leaves, failure to produce carbohydrates. Next, magnesium. Function, production of chlorophyll. And what are the effects of deficiency? Slow, retarded growth, yellowing of leaves. Then iron, production of chlorophyll, and effects, yellowing of leaves deficiency, right? Manganese, production of main plant hormones. And what are the effects of deficiency? Retarded growth, spotted leaves. Okay, then zinc, production of hormones and their intermediates. And effects of deficiency: retarded growth, yellowing of leaves. So you can understand how important nutrients, how importance of nutrients in the plants are. Now, nutrition in animals. This concept refers to the body's need for nutrients, mode of ingesting food and its use in the body. children. Three factors involved in nutrition in animals are need for nutrients, mode of ingestion, and its use in the body. Nutrients are obtained from food. All the life processes run efficiently due to nutrients. The circulating blood supplies the nutrients to all parts of the body. For this purpose, the food is converted into soluble forms by an elaborate process. There are five steps that occur in nutrition are as follows. Steps in nutrition. Ingestion. Food is taken into the body. Digestion. Conversion of food into simple soluble forms. Absorption. Transfer of soluble food to the food blood. Assimilation. Utilization of absorbed food by cells and tissues for energy production, growth and repair. Egestion. Removal of waste products and undigested foods from the body. Got it, children? Now, types of nutrition in animals. Holozoic nutrition. See, let me read for you all. Holozoic nutrition. In unicellular organisms like amoeba, Euglena, Paramecium, all the processes of nutrition occur in the same cell. Multicellular animals ingest the food through mouth. Insects like cockroach and grasshopper and nibbling insects, jaw-like mouth parts. Butterflies, they are having a tube-like proboscis for sucking the food. Mosquitoes and bed bugs, needle-like mouth part for piercing and a tube-like mouth part for sucking the blood and fluids. Got it, children? Next, animals with different food habits. According to the types of food, animals can be classified as: first, herbivorous. Animals that feed on plant matter such as grass, fruits, seeds, etc. Example, grazing animals, carnivorous or gramnivorous, seed eaters, frugivores means fruit eaters. Okay. Then carnivorous, animals that depend on other animals for their food are carnivorous. Carnivorous depend on herbivorous for their food and thus are indirectly dependent on plant matter for food. Example, animals feeding on herbivorous. Animals that feed on insects. Okay, animals feeding on herbivorous, they are predators. And animals that feed on insects, they are insectivorous. Then omnivorous. Animals feeding on both plants and animals, example monkey, chimpanzees, human, okay, they are omnivorous. And scavengers obtain their food from dead bodies of animals, example vulture, crow, hyena, okay. And then decomposers. In some microbes decompose the dead and decaying organic matter and convert it back to inorganic compounds by decomposition process. Decomposers clean and conserve the environment while feeding. These are decomposers. Okay. Now comes second, saprozoic nutrition. What is this saprozoic nutrition, children? In saprozoic nutrition, animals decompose the dead and decaying organic matter and utilize it as the food. Example, the insect, unicellular animals, houseflies, ants, spiders. Got it? Now, parasitic nutrition. Have you seen small animals on the bodies of animals like dogs and buffaloes? Which are those small animals? Yes, on the bodies of pet animals, there are parasitic organisms like flea, ticks, and mites. Sometimes leeches are also seen. On the dogs and all, you can see. From where do the little animals obtain their food? These parasites obtain blood from their host animals. From where do the worms in the intestine obtain their food? Digested food having useful nutrients in the host intestine is taken by the worms living inside the intestine of the host. Now, see, parasitic nutrition is seen in some animals. The dependent animal is said to be a parasite. While the animal from which a parasite obtains the food is called a host. Parasite does not survive without a host. Therefore, it will not kill the host, as in case of prey and predator relationship. Parasites are mainly of two types: ectoparasitic parasites and endoparasites. Ectoparasitic nutrition is what? In this type, the parasites are seen living on the body surface of the host, and obtaining food by sucking the blood or body juices. Example: louse, bed bug, tick. And endoparasitic nutrition is what? In this type, the parasites live inside the body of a host. They consume the ready-made digested food from host. Example: tapeworm and roundworm. Got it, children? Yes. Here our lesson gets over. Answers I'll give you in another video.